Hey everybody, Maya here. As I promised earlier in the day, I am live to talk to you about why I love naysayers. Who are the naysayers? They're the people who just every time you try to do something, they try to shoot you down. Hey, Lisa. The naysayers, they might feel like your enemies, but they might be in your family. One of your naysayers might be your best friend or the person in your mastermind. Hey, Rita. Hi, Diana. Hey, Aaron. Ooh, what a cool group. Hey, Barbara. Woo, what a fun group today. All right, so let's just start off by identifying what a naysayer is. They're the person who shoots you down, who bursts your bubble. I remember years ago, I was talking to a friend, like, I don't know, I shared this good news, and then my mom said this. It could be your mom. And my friend said, I hate when people put their bad vibe all over my thing. And I thought, oh, I like that. Because it feels like that, doesn't it? Like a naysayer just like puts this bad vibe on your good thing. It's like you're feeling all bubbly. And then they're just like, they don't even have to say anything, right? You could be on the phone and they could just be like, there could be a quality to their listening that is just a very bad vibe. So these are our naysayers. They can be people we know, people we love, people we like much of the time. I have a great friend, absolutely love and adore this friend, and occasionally, she and I've done it to her too, have put our bad vibe on the other person because there's something happening inside of me, right? When she says her thing, I get triggered and then she responds to my weirdness. So it doesn't have to be malicious necessarily. It can be somebody you love. It can be somebody who ostensibly is there to support you. It can be someone who is not malicious. But they have their own view of the world or their own pattern that they are trying to uphold and like trying to maybe make you be in a supporting role in their movie, right? But aren't we the stars of our own shows? I know the people that I am friends with and I work with, we're greatly of service in many cases, and there is this soul desire to be the star of our own show. You know, I actually think, just sort of taking a little aside for a second, someone like Mother Teresa, right? We look at her as like being of service and being selfless. But that was really her soul calling, and she loved that. And she was the star of the Mother Teresa show. Okay, so I want to just get really clear here that when you're following your soul mission, your soul calling, that it can look like you're the star of your show, or it can look like you're in a supporting role, but you will know inside yourself which it is. Okay, hey, Melissa. Rita says, I've wondered whether my husband has served as resistance training to develop my strengths. Yes. Yes, it's very possible. Hey, Claudia. Ooh, someone I haven't seen in a long time. So, all right, what have we decided? Your naysayers are the people who kind of burst your bubble, shoot you down. You could love them, you could be related to them, you could like them at many other times, but for some reason, in this moment when you're like trying to burst into bloom, they say something or react in a way that just is crushing. And maybe they say something. You know, I talk to a lot of people, right, about like where this thing started in childhood, why I'm hiding and holding back now and not ready to step out, because we've all been wounded in some way. So we all need permission that it's going to be safe if we step out. And then what happens? As soon as you have this vision or this dream or some way that you want to step out, it could be doing a Facebook Live, posting your true opinion on social media. It could be feeding your child something different than most people feed their children. I don't know. Think of something for yourself right now. Hey, Pat. Hi, Robin. Think of a place where you have this little urge, just like what I would call a soul desire, and it can be teeny tiny, where you just like want to step out a little more. It could be big and bold too, okay? So whatever occurs to you. And you are holding back because you're afraid of what someone else is going to think or say or just feel in reaction to what you want to do. And you do not want to experience that. Just take a moment, and you can share it if you want to in the comments, or you can just kind of think of it to yourself. Okay. Hey, Robin. I've got two Robins on. So what happens when you have this soul desire and you want to put it out in the world? And this could be, again, anything. It could be you want to read a poem out loud somewhere at an open mic. It could be you want to sing karaoke or like ask somebody on a date. It could be something like your career or your calling. There's a million different ways, large and small, that you might be getting this like inner directive to express yourself out in the world. And you hold back because you've got this concern that somebody is going to say or do something that's going to make you feel bad, and so you don't do it. All right, here's why naysayers are your best friends on that journey to expressing yourself fully. Melissa says, my sole desire is to homestead. No one really thinks I'm weird for that, but they do look at me with a side eye. Interesting. That's really interesting. Isn't that interesting? I wonder why. Do you know why they look at you with a side eye? Because sometimes, I had somebody say this to me years ago. I was talking about wanting to be an actress, but I was working as a rape crisis counselor. And another counselor in the office said to me, well, I want to be an artist too, but at a certain point you realize those are just dreams. Okay, so she was angry at me for wanting to step out and go be an actress because she had killed off her dream and gone the practical route. And so she was not giving herself permission to express herself and follow her dream. So sometimes people give you the side eye because they actually want to do the thing. Hey, Susan. Okay, I've got four reasons why naysayers who look like your enemies or your frenemies or the people who are trying to take you down are amazing for you. Okay? Okay. The first reason is that, and this is, I'm a life coach, total personal growth reason. You might hate this reason, but they will expose your hidden vulnerabilities. A naysayer, if you step out, let's say you wear a skirt, you never wore a skirt before, and now you're wearing a skirt, and somebody gives you the side eye, like Melissa said, and now you feel really vulnerable and exposed, you know that you have some kind of a belief or something about yourself in a skirt that they just pointed out to you. And now you have a choice about what you can do. The obvious easy route is to never put a skirt on again, but now you've just killed off a soul dream. So where are you going to wind up? On your deathbed, pissed off at yourself, miserable, because you didn't do what you were desiring to do. The other option is confront yourself and figure out, why do I have such a vulnerability here? Right? And that is like the deep, dark work that's not always fun. But if you come at it with an attitude of fuck it, right? I want to wear a skirt. I don't know why I have this soul calling, but I want to, so I'm going to do it. Never mind the naysayers. Then you overcome your vulnerability and you create a strength and you're a more whole version of you. So that's reason one why your naysayers, the people who shoot you down, are amazing for you because they will expose your vulnerabilities. And now, yeah, you can run back and hide and scurry in your hole. I've done that. And maybe you need a reprieve, right? To go kind of nurse your wounds or find somebody who's actually going to be encouraging of you in the way that you want to step out. And then your other option is just to like heal that old wound. That's always an option that's available to you. All right. Reason number two. Why naysayers are worthy of our love, because they will show you who you really are. Have you ever noticed that some friend of yours gets just really bothered by this one thing, and you're like, I don't really get why you're so upset by that. It doesn't really, I mean, it's not really that important to me. Or you're just like, God, do you not see how important this is? And everybody else is like, no, I don't really get why that doesn't really. So when you step out or you have a soul desire of some kind that you want to express yourself in a certain way, this could be as simple as a haircut. Right? I mean, seriously, it could be as simple as a haircut. And then people are going to say a thing about your haircut, and you're going to see what matters to you. Self-expression or haircuts maybe matter to you. Hey, Jennifer. And this, how you react in this moment, how you respond to the naysayer, will show you who you really are, because it will show you now in this moment if you are going to be a victim of circumstance, or if you're going to take a stand and be the creator of your existence, right? You know how a second ago I was talking about, well, when somebody shoots you down and bursts your bubble, you have the option to run and hide. Okay, you always have the option to like take yourself out of the game, chill out. I recently have spent some time under a blanket in the darkened living room, just like sort of, I don't know if I can do it. Okay, so permission always to go like, take care of yourself. But when you're really following your soul calling here in this lifetime, whatever it is, you're going to have to break out of the mold. You're going to have to break some rules, whether it's family rules, rules about women, what women do or don't do, what men do or don't do, how old you are. Are you too old for that? That's just a rule that either your family has or your friends have or society has. And so you can just adhere to that rule. But if you have that feeling inside you, like, your how do I want to say this? This feeling like you're letting yourself down, then that means by not doing the thing, you are being a victim of what other people think or do, and they have some control over you, and you're just adhering to a rule that's not right for you. And so in order to be the creator of your life, you're going to have to break some rules. Hey, Barbara. Hey, Sunny. And I realize I mixed up two things. Okay, I'm gonna review for the people who are just joining, okay? And I'm gonna clarify something. Why do I love naysayers and the people who shoot you down? Because they expose your hidden vulnerabilities. And now you can see what really is wounded in you. And now you have the option to go fix it. Because everything is healable. I really believe that. Everything is healable. I don't care what it is. Sexual abuse, eating disorder, addiction, anything, whatever it is. Your voice not working when you go to sing and you really want to sing, writer's block, it's all healable. A job you've been in for the past 40 years and you want to move out of that job and into something else, totally fixable, okay? So naysayers will expose your hidden vulnerabilities and they're going to show you who you really are if you're a victim or a creator. And this is where I mixed it up before. I say that naysayers illuminate your true path. Because, like I said a minute ago, they're going to show you what really matters to you. I was having this conversation with a client the other day. I voted. I don't know if it's a mirror image for you, but I did vote today. I just absolutely cannot stand politics. I just absolutely fucking hate. It's like there's constantly an election, something I'm supposed to care about, and I do not want to participate. Okay? I voted. But here's my point. I have a client, she's in her 20s, and she is so passionate about justice and rights and activism. And she said to me something like, well, I mean, everybody. And I was like, I know, I'm not interested. I do not want to participate in that game. But you get all riled up over it, and it is clearly sending you the message that your path includes activism, because that really matters to you. Hey, Elena. Hey, Jacqueline. What a cool group today. If you have anything you want me to speak to, you can type it into the comments. Some of you are saying, feeling it more than ever right now. Spot on. Makes sense. Cool. Glad that what I'm saying is landing. I mean, I have been dealing with this myself a lot, right? Like, every time I have, the first time I posted a post to Facebook, like sharing, I don't remember what it was. This is 4 or 5 years ago, I posted to Facebook something I really cared about relating to personal growth and my life coaching practice. And I was so panicked that I shut my computer down and left my apartment and went for a walk because it just felt so risky and like I was exposing so much and that I was really vulnerable because people could naysay me and it was going to hurt me. But after stepping out a lot over these years, like, a lot, you know, retracting, hiding on the couch under the covers, stepping out again, taking a breather, stepping out again. it's gotten easier. And so the naysayers, I might feel in the moment like, oh, that was a low blow, but it's not going to hold me back anymore. Melissa says, we are cool because you are cool. It sure is landing. Good. Okay. So what did I say? That your naysayers are going to serve you because they're going to expose your hidden vulnerabilities. I remember a few years ago, I do not have children. I am turning 46 this year. I don't have children. And one of my life's biggest dreams was to have kids. When I was 40, I got broken up with by the man that I thought that was finally going to happen with. And simultaneously, I got diagnosed with fibroids, endometriosis, and ovarian cysts. And they wanted to do a hysterectomy and take the ovaries and everything. And it was this moment of, wow, I'm not going to have children. And there was that's a whole story for another time, how I processed that. And it certainly took time. But after a couple, like 2 or 3 years after that experience happened, I was working at a restaurant job in the Hudson Valley. And this coworker of mine, very outspoken, playful, odd guy, he said to me at one point, we're all hanging out. It was this guy, me, and a bunch of other young women who were waitresses there. And he said, I don't know what I was saying. I was being ridiculous. And he said, do you have children? And I said, no, I don't. And he said, good, because you're crazy and we wouldn't want your DNA passed on. And all the young women around just gasped and looked at the two of us. And I just started laughing. I don't know why I thought that was funny in the moment. There was no, I didn't have a hidden vulnerability there. He said this horrible thing, right? That 2 or 3 years prior would have probably made me burst into tears, but I had done all this inner work and there wasn't a hidden vulnerability there. So what he actually exposed to me was that I had healed a wound there. And I went home and I thought about that. I kept thinking like, that's so interesting. He said this thing like, I'm glad you don't have children. And I laughed and I feel light about it inside myself now. Damn, I really did some inner work and healing around the fact that I'm not a mother. And what was actually adorable is the next day I got to work and he showed up early and he got down on one knee in front of me and he presented a gift. It was this beautiful little turtle from Mexico. And he said, I'm so sorry. I like to press boundaries and I like to play and I crossed a line yesterday and I'm so sorry. And I was like, ooh, thank you for the little present. But it was this beautiful moment where I could see how far I'd come and how much I had healed. Melissa says, hey, Karen. Ooh, Karen's here from Korea. Wow, cool to have you here. What time is it over there? Karen, did you encounter any naysayers when you decided to leave New York? What was it, last week? Karen left New York City a couple of weeks ago and moved to South Korea. That's a big move. I'm wondering if there were any naysayers for you in that, Karen. Melissa says, I'm trying hard to think of my naysayers, and I realized I've worked hard to let them go, that they are no longer around. That's awesome. Melissa, what about there was that woman at work? How's it going with her? Karen says, it's early morning. Oh, congratulations, Karen. That is just like huge that you did that. I'm so excited for you. I want to also, there's one last thing. Okay, so naysayers will expose your hidden vulnerabilities. Good, because then we can fix them. They'll show you who you really are, if you're a victim or a creator. Because if you're a victim, then you're just a victim of circumstances in your life, right? I've been there. I have been there. I really, for a long time, thought that life was something that just happened to you, and some people were lucky and some people weren't, and there was nothing you could do about it. And that sucks. That's a victim stance to come at life. And I was wondering why nothing was working. Now, I'm not saying you can control life with your mind. Don't we wish that we could? But to be the creator of your existence and go, huh, there's got to be a creative solution to this. Because other people are doing it. Why can't you? Right? Melissa says that the woman who used to be a naysayer at work is now her BFF, LOL. She has new targets now. Interesting. Hey, Silas. Sai is here. This is fun. It's a great mix of people. Okay, so they'll expose your hidden vulnerabilities. Good, then you can fix that. They'll show you who you really are. Are you a victim or creator? Cool, because then you can see why your life might not be working. They'll illuminate your true path by showing you what really pisses you off or hurts you, and you will know what matters to you. That's important if you're going to build a life that's like your true life, right? And the final point I want to make is that naysayers, the people who shoot you down and try to burst your bubble when you do something a little bit different, they are the gatekeepers to you claiming your gifts and your soul mission. And what I mean by that is I've been having a conversation. I have a free private group here on Facebook. If you would like to have this kind of conversation in private, send me a message, or you can look up the Rule Breakers Freedom Forum. Okay, that's my free group here on Facebook, Rule Breakers Freedom Forum. And what we've been talking about this week is that often when we're little kids and we're just expressive and like exploring the world and we don't have any shame yet, right? We just like, we've got a clear channel for our soul and our personality to express. And guess what? Your family comes around, your mom, your grandmother, whoever it is. I had a Czech grandmother. Man, I can still hear her voice and feel her influence like 40 years later, right? They will come in and they will shame you right where your gifts are. For me, it was always, I told this story in my newsletter today and that we've been talking about in the Rule Breakers Freedom Forum this week, about how when I was a kid, there was this big story. My family loves to still tell it. My mother told this story 2 weeks ago, okay? And that's why it was up for me, about how I started talking when I was 2 years old in complete sentences, and I've just never stopped talking since. And what that meant was my little sister couldn't get a word in edgewise, so she didn't even speak a sentence until she was 3 years old. If I can tell you how embarrassing that was for me as a kid to hear that story told over and over again, because guys, I don't know if you can tell, but I am a talker. I'm a writer and I'm a talker. I'm a talker, I'm a writer, okay? I've learned how to listen better over the years, and I've learned how to be silent and quiet and listen to my inner voice over the years, because I just sucked at those things for a long time. First person to admit that, okay? But here's the point. 2 weeks ago, I met some people. And they had just come from doing a radio show. And I was like, ooh, I've always wanted to be on the radio. And my mom was right there. And she's like, nah, yeah. And then, do you know what she did? She told the story about, well, Maya started talking complete sentences when she was 1 year old. And I was like, what? I get younger every time you tell this story. And oh, and her sister didn't even learn to speak because, right, the whole story happened. Guess what I did? I went home. And I fucking pitched a radio show to this place. Did I hide? Did I feel that shame? No, because you know what? I know that talking is one of my strengths. I love to talk, and you can tell me if I'm wrong. I'm pretty good at it, right? I'm not like at a loss for words. So I'm gonna have my own radio show, and it airs this Friday. I'll post a link, and I would love it if you guys all showed up and listened in, because that makes it scarier. And I like that, right? Keeps me on my toes. But think about it in your own life. Where is the place when you were a little kid just expressing yourself freely and somebody stopped you and shamed you? Is it possible that right now, as a grown-up, as an old person, right? Because don't you sort of feel like, my God, I've been alive a long time, and right? What is it, dance? Or is it being really serious? Maybe you're a preacher in your heart and your soul. Maybe you're a teacher. I don't know what it is for you. Hey, Patty. Oh, Lorianne, hi. Oh, what a cool group today. Great to see everybody. And sometimes this stuff is really subtle, okay? So I was at a party over the weekend, didn't know a lot of people. One of the guys that I knew introduced me to a friend of his as his life coach. I am not his life coach, but he said, this is Maya, she's my life coach. And she turned to me, I'd never met this woman before, and she said, what does a life coach do? And I was like, oh, I hate that question, okay? But then I just said something really quick, like, you know, help people figure out what they really want and then get the courage to go for it. She took that totally dismissed me. So I got naysayed by this total stranger at a party. And she looked at him and she said, what are you, 40 something? And you still don't know what you want to do with your life? You have a job. Why would you need to do something different? That's naysaying. That's it right there. Why? Because she wanted to keep him small. I can't even give you all her reasons. Who the hell knows? But my sense of her was that she's a small town girl, me too, but she didn't like, it made her uncomfortable when people started to break free and do other things. And it was actually the second time I met this woman for 5 minutes. It was the second time she had made a comment that was like, stay small, stay inside this little zone that we have created here that we all agree with. And he, to his credit, my friend, was like, I'm still trying to figure out what I want to be when I grow up. And he handled it really well, and he let it roll off his shoulders. She was bored with our conversation. She said her little naysaying piece. She left, and he leaned in, and he said, do you know that I really regret that I didn't join the military after high school? And I still am dealing with that, and I don't know what to do about it. Now, that is a key moment in someone's life, right? Because we can swallow those regrets and ignore them, and then guess what? We're going to be on our deathbed going, what the fuck just happened? And you're going to be angry at yourself. I don't know about you, but I want to live a life where there's freedom for me to be me and to express myself and to be surrounded by people who might not understand me all the time, but they're cheering me on anyway. And I want to do that for you and for everybody. Letting go of shame, somebody suggests a book. Hey, Rick. Melissa says, sounds like she prefers to stay in the same place and remain status quo. Now listen, if that's your soul calling and other people are trying to push you out, you don't listen to them. They're your naysayers. I read this blog a while back. The title was trying to be provocative. She wrote something like, why I want to live a mediocre life. Because, you know, in the world now of like entrepreneurism and coaching and everybody living their best life and all that, there's a lot of actual pressure to go big, and not everybody wants to go big. So if your soul calling is to live a quiet life that's internal or that small town, go you. And if people try to push you to go do something else, they're like, you should go to college. You're like, I don't want to fucking go to college. Right? If that's your soul desire to then you do that and you ignore your naysayers. Let's see. Humans aren't static. We learn and grow. Don't let anyone stop you. Excellent. Excellent point. Wow. Anything else, gang? You've been such a great back and forth here with me. And as you can tell, I'm feeling really impassioned about this because I feel like so many of us are being called to express ourselves and grow, like the comment just came through that humans aren't static. And then we stop ourselves, and then who's the one to live with the regrets? We are. God, does that ever wake you up in the middle of the night? Oh, absolutely it does. So what is it that you really desire? Who's your naysayer? And who are the people you know you can go to for support? Again, you could always come to my Rule Breakers Freedom Forum. And if you like this, I'm going to be doing some more Facebook Live soon, but keep an eye out. My radio show, it's called The Moment. And it's all about getting in the moment so you can tune in, hear your inner voice, and then like step through the fire to have the courage to express yourself. Okay, so we're going to be talking about a bunch of things on that theme on WIOXradio.org if you're going to stream online, or WIOX if you're in Central New York, 91.3 this Friday at 1 p.m. Eastern. And I'm just going to be posting relentlessly about it because I'd love to know that you guys were all out there joining me over the airwaves. Melissa says she refuses to live in regrets. Thank you, Karen. I'm glad you thought this was a great Facebook Live. Lisa says, yes, we suffer when we hold ourselves back. Mwah, she says. Oh, mwah, that was a kiss. I thought you were like, mwah, I'm stepping out no matter what they say. And Rita says, ooh, she likes that, finding the middle path. Jennifer says, working on how to, I think you mean to say reside in the moment. It used to happen so much that I didn't notice. Now at least, Jennifer, what are you saying there? Working on how to resin in the moment. There's a word I think that Facebook corrected for you. Rita says the energy we have to live our life is our total energy minus the amount we are using to hold ourselves back. That is really profound. If we have a finite amount of energy and we're using a portion of that energy to hold ourselves back and pretend that we're somebody we're not really, we're using up our finite life energy. God, that's deep. Barbara says, great video. Yes, yes, lots to think about. Love seeing you too, Barbara. Cool. Respond. To respond in the moment. Yeah, and you have to be conscious and aware, right? I know. That's what we're going to be talking about on my radio show, because it's like scary to be, this is scary, right, to step out. So you want to surround yourself. Not only, the naysayers will show up no matter what, and you don't want to live in a bubble, right, because you see how they can guide you, but you also need to make sure that you're supported. So feel free to join my free Facebook group, the Rule Breakers Freedom Forum, where you can talk and it's private. It won't get displayed all over Facebook. All right? Cool. Oh, so good to see everybody. I will see you the next time I do one of these, and on Facebook. Lots of love to you all.